Hey everyone, welcome to this Force Friday's live session. Today we're going to be talking to you guys about supplies, right? Supplies is something that comes up, you know, with almost every drawing, and it's a common question that I see show up on Instagram and in forums, right? The question is always like, what are you working with, right? What is that supply? So as a precursor to today's session, I want to make clear, it's not really the supply that makes the artist, right? It's the artist that makes the supply, right? So let's just, you know, keep that in mind, right? So I'm going to be, each one of us is going to cover the supplies that we most often use. Diego and I will be primarily talking about traditional supplies. We'll have Mritunjay and Swenley closing out today with a mixture between drawing with traditional and digital supplies. So let's just get started, right? I'm gonna move my camera over so you guys can see my paper setup. So just give me a second here to do so. Let's go. Let's go here. And we're gonna shut off this background. There we go. All right, can you guys see my paper?
Yeah.
Yes.
Okay, great. All right, so I thought the first thing we would talk about before I get into the supplies I actually use is an awareness of that there are different, you know, there's a spread of how graphite is measured, okay? The two basic tools that I use, by the way, when I'm drawing are graphite. Sorry, I
need to spotlight your video because you're small on the screen.
Oh, yeah, sure. Yeah. Let me pin it.
Hello, everyone, by the way.
Hey, guys, sorry. I'm so worried about the tech and making sure everyone can see. Hello, Diego, Mritunjay, and Swenley. How are you guys doing?
Hey, one by one.
Yeah.
We're fine. I'm fine. Thank you. Thank you so much. How are you? Hey. Okay.
So let's see. I'm going to move in on this. Okay. So the first thing to be aware of when it comes to supplies is that there is a grading system to graphite, right? So graphite basically goes from, you know, from the H side. Let's see. I want to make sure you guys could see. All right. It goes from the H side basically to the B side, right? H is hard. I haven't actually ever looked up why B is B, what that stands for. I just always remember the H is the hard side, right? In the middle here, you have HB, okay? And then you basically progressively go up in number from the center. On the H side, from
you again, but you're still small on the screen.
Oh, I am, sorry. Hold on.
Yeah, you can stop sharing the screen, your computer screen. So
yes. Thank you. There we go.
That's amazing.
Okay, there we go. Thank you. So you have B on one side, you have H on the other side, and you have HB in the middle, right? I think there's an F. I haven't bought F in a long time, and I think it's to the left of HB. And the point to all this is, as you go up in number to the left, it gets harder, and as you go up in number to the right, it gets softer, right? So hardness is this way, and the leads get softer this way, right? So like a common pencil here would be like a 2B, right? A 2B pencil is a pretty common pencil. I think this is pretty close to what like a school like Ticonderoga pencil would be. I think it's in this like 2B range, right? And then you go down to the H's. I don't know how high the H's go. I think I've seen as high as like a 6H. I'm sure it goes higher than that, but I think I've had 6H pencils. And on the B side, at least when it comes to wood pencils, the highest I've seen so far, in fact, is what I'm holding. And that's a 10B pencil. And that's this Mitsubishi pencil. I picked this one up because I love Glenn Keane and I heard that Glenn was using these. So I was like, oh my God, it's 10B. I have to try it. And I usually work in this range as well. Like most of my drawing when it comes to graphite is I usually live in this much softer range of graphite. So I wanted to share with you how I even got here. When I went to school, when I was in college, I went to SVA. I had two main figure drawing instructors. One was Jim McMullen, the other one was John Ruggieri. Those guys, I basically lived and breathed their philosophies for 3 years with those guys. And one class we used 2B pencil all the time, and it was on something called ledger bond. Now, this drove me crazy, quite frankly, because the paper was really expensive, super, super expensive, right? This is, you know, if you look at restaurants, I would say this was like a $4 signed paper, right? And I hated that. And the paper was smaller and I hated it because I was always worried about like how fast I was burning through the paper. I had like money in the back of my mind as I was drawing, which I didn't like. So I would squash like a lot of figure drawings onto one sheet, and plus the paper wasn't that large. So that was like one class. The other class, ironically, we drew with charcoal all the time, wood charcoal. So in a wooden pencil like this, but it would be charcoal instead of graphite, right? And this was fine. You know, it gets obviously a little bit messy and it's got a little bit of grit to it. And it was basically charcoal on like a basic white paper. So years later, when I started teaching, I swore that I would get rid of this. I really hated the fact that I went through that. And especially nowadays, we know how expensive art school is. I said, you know what, I'm going to find a paper that's cheap. So that led me to newsprint, which is what I'm drawing on right now, right? So that led me to newsprint. And more importantly, not only newsprint, but smooth newsprint. Got to be smooth, okay? Especially since then I started teaching force and I started formulating what force was going to look and feel like, what I wanted the experience to be. Smooth is the key, right? And I have to tell you, most professional artists, even if they're not on smooth and they're going and buying, let's say, sketchbooks, they'll usually look for smoother paper, not rough paper. Rough paper is typically used for something like watercolor, right? Watercolor paper in general has a rough texture to it because it's like a sponge, it's absorbent. You don't want anything that's really rough because all it's going to do is basically just literally tear down the tip of your pencil or graphite, whatever you're drawing with, and it's going to rip it apart. Smooth, you know, your line is a lot crisper on smooth paper than it is on rough paper, right? So you're looking for smooth newsprint. Super, super important. This is the biggest mistake I see students make is they get rough paper, okay? And sometimes, depending on the company, when you go to buy newsprint, it doesn't even say on the cover what it is, right? So if it doesn't tell you, I would be cautious because it's probably not smooth. Rough seems to be like the common cheap newsprint paper. So you want to look specifically for smooth. So super important is the paper. By the way, all of the supplies I'm going to be covering today and the other guys are covering today, we're going to put links to all of this stuff into the description. I already took care of the ones I'm going to share with you today. The other guys are going to send that over. So we're going to cover that. I'm also going to put in the description a link to the digital brushes that we use as well. Okay, it's not in there yet, but check back later today. That will be in the description. Okay. So anyway, this was my story, right? I basically came in through these supplies. I liked graphite a lot. I wasn't too crazy about the charcoal. I knew the paper I wanted to have be smooth. So I started here. Once I started there and I started teaching more full time, I went away from graphite and I actually started with a China marker. So this is where it all began for me. This one's by a company called Fano. What I liked about China marker, first of all, it was wax, right? And I loved the cleanliness of it. I hated like charcoal being all over the place and messy and just breathing it in and having it all over my clothes. And I want something that would still give me good line. So I started with China marker. It wasn't Fano. I honestly don't remember what company I used, you know, 25 years ago. Some of you may not be aware of China marker and how it works. You know, so you buy this thing and it's got a string hanging out of it. And it's like, how does this thing work? Well, it's wrapped with wood. And it's got perforations in it, which you can't, you know, you probably won't be able to see here. So the idea is to pull this string down past a perforation, right? And then grab it in there. And you're supposed to be able to just like pull this off, right? Like so. Now you can see I've got almost like a half pref. This is a perforation, but if you grab it on every two, I guess, on this particular Fano China marker, you know, you can see it tears off. Now, what I don't like about this one specifically is you can see I have to like turn the China marker to make this peel occur, right? When I was in Italy a couple of years ago, I found these China markers out there. This is by a company called Diamond, right? As you can see here, it's got this light pinkish paper. So same thing, I would pull this down and rip it and it would tear off the way it used to when I went to school, which is like this, right? That's a good China marker, right? The fact that I could just rip down and pull it immediately and pull it right off the end like that, that's what you want, right? Because it's really fast, right? And you can immediately get to work, right? So I worked on China marker and had my students using China marker for years. A majority of the drawings in the Force drawing books, especially the first one, now the 10th anniversary, are done with China marker, okay? So we did that for quite a few years. After China marker, I actually moved on to these guys, right? So this is Carandash. You can buy in packages or you can buy singles. They usually sell these big packs. It's kind of fun to get the big pack if you want to do drawings with multiple colors or you want to work in phases. So for instance, you might pick one color as like your thinking phase and then pick black as like a cleanup or trying to clear up your drawing. They look like crayons, basically, right? It's like adult crayon box, right? Instead of Crayola. They're a little softer, a little waxier than Crayola is, a little more dense. So here are some that I've already used, right? Looks like this. And you could see what's great about these is, first of all, because of their size, notice how I'm holding this. I'm not holding it the way I write. With the China markers, most of the time with the China marker, I would draw the way I hold it when I'm writing my name, right? Or I'm writing words, right? Like this, so like an overhand grip. So let's call this overhand, by the way, we'll call this underhand, right? So this is underhand, this is overhand, right? So overhand grip on the China markers, as it got smaller, I think I have some small ones here. Yeah, so here's a small one I have, it's blue, right? Then I would start holding it underhand. So it's like this, you see? Now, the benefit of China markers, it's wax, and you can still get good line out of it, you know, as you can see. Again, it depends on me, right? I'm controlling this thing. So the light to dark and the dark to light is all me and my sense of pressure. But I think what happened is I noticed as these got smaller like this, I really enjoyed drawing like this. I was quite frankly against it during most of my years at SVA. I was like, just draw the way you write. I wasn't really into this sort of fancy grip, but I realized as these got smaller like this, because of the size, it felt more like the tool was part of my body, right? It's part of my arm. It didn't feel like I was holding, you know, a tool in my hand anymore. This really felt like it was part of my hand. So that led me to these smaller drawing tools. And then that led me to the Carandash. Carandash is typically softer than the China marker. The good thing about both of these, I would say for today, is if you're photographing your art or your drawings, right? Because this is wax, it's got a somewhat matte finish to it. And that matte finish photographs better, right? The graphite has some reflectivity on it. So that could like detract from actually being able to see the drawing clearly. The downside to the wax is it has a little bit of grippiness to it, okay? So even though it looks like I'm drawing smoothly, you know, I can feel it wanting to grab the paper a little bit. If I come in very lightly and gently, what I call soft touch, then it's fine. Like this works good. As I start to push down, I can feel it wanting to grab the graphite a little bit, right? So I'm constantly like, you know, fighting that. It's not like it's any kind of big fight. I mean, it's very subtle, right? But it's not the same thing as graphite. So I worked with this for years. Again, this is very slow progression we're talking about. Right, so we went from 2B pencils, I used charcoal in high school, always on the newsprint. That led me to China marker. The shrinking of China marker led me to Carandash, right? And not that long ago, I would say, to me, not that long because I'm 50, maybe like 8 or 10 years ago, I found something called these Lyra graphite sticks. I don't recall how I found this. I think somebody brought this to my attention actually in a class. So here's a Lyra graphite. Right. So with Lyra graphite, the thing to look for is they have two types. They have water soluble and like non-water soluble. I actually prefer the water soluble because it's blacker, it's darker, you know. And I've always been striving to find a tool that was somewhere in between like wax and graphite. So I want the smoothness of the graphite, but the blackness of the wax. I'm still actually searching for that today, right? To really find that perfect thing. But the Lyra graphite is pretty darn good. And I like that it was fat, right? Like really fat. So this, by the way, is a 6B, as you can see here. Don't confuse this if you go to the store and think it's a 9B, right? And hold this upside down and think, oh, you know, I thought I saw a 9. I've actually had students do that. So be aware, the B comes after the number. So this number is upright like this. I have a 9B here. I'm not sure why one is blue and one is gray. This one's a little harder to see. But, you know, up in there, it actually says 9B, right? So here's what's interesting about this. The way I use this is I take this and I do this to it. Right? I break this in half and I take the paper off of it. Okay. I break it in half so I can just, it's fat. I want it small, right? So I want it like this in my hands. Now that it's so small, you know, what I do is I draw on its side. So my fingers are touching the paper and my pointer finger is on top of the graphite. And that's how I push down. And by the way, most of the time, you know, when I start a drawing, I'll start like this in the top left corner. And I'll just try to get a nice fat, soft line like I'm getting right now. You see, after doing this for a while, this actually morphs into this, right? So this is the thing you guys may have heard me talk. Let me try to get this in camera. You may have heard me talk about before. I call this the silver bullet, right? So you can see this guy with all of its chisels edges turns into this. You can see the gradation on the sides gets really long and flat. It's almost like a lipstick or a bullet, right? So this, when it gets to this, I'm like, all right, I've got it where I want it, right? Like this is the way I like drawing with this, right? So because of that, you know, I have a really fat wide tool I can draw. Hold on, I can draw very wide and fat with it, right? So I've got like the full side of it and I could draw force with it if I want. I'm literally on the whole side right now, by the way. It's almost like a calligraphy pencil in a way, because I'm going from wide to narrow based on the angle, right? You can see how wide it is up here and it gets narrow. And I'll just like flow around with it, even at this very broad edge. And then if I want to sharpen it up, I just tilt up on it, right? So I just come up and I tilt down on it and I get more of the point that I want, you see? Right? So this is the tool I've been using, like I said, for about the last 8 or 10 years. All the drawings you've seen in that time period have been done with this guy, right? Some of the new videos on the site, I'll go to one of the waxes purely because I'm videotaping and I want you to have more clarity, right? So there's not as much reflectivity. One last piece I'm going to share with you. Two other things real quick. This I'll draw with every so often. This is called, this is a Generals pencil, sketching pencil. Generals is in the US. It's one of the few graphite companies actually in the United States. This is like a carpenter's pencil, right? Carpenters use this kind of pencil. It's got this interesting shape to it. This is a 6B, right? So pretty soft for a carpenter's pencil. I like, again, that it's got a chiseled edge. It's almost like drawing with a calligraphy marker, right? So I can go from thin lines to fat lines based on what direction I draw in. And I personally really like that. You know, I like the flare of this, right? Plus I can, when I'm drawing, if I want to, I can turn it on its corner and get the very little tip of it, right? So there's a lot of range in line, right? It's like thin, sharp line, fatter, softer lines. Why does this matter? This matters because the more you can squeeze out of the tool you're using, the more expression you have in your work, right? The more expression, meaning you have more ability to talk about the things you want to talk about, you see? So last but not least, before I close out and I hand it off, I grabbed a bunch of drawings to show you, just to show you what those different supplies look like, right? So this is Lyra graphite, right? Lyra graphite's great for soft touching, like I showed you before. You know, this is drawn with the little silver bullet, right? So this drawing is created with this supply, right? Any of the graphite stuff I show you today, it's with this guy. If I wanted to go into this and do some sharper work, like on the face, then I'd probably go to the Mitsubishi like 10B pencil, right? Because super soft. So that's graphite. That's all Lyra. This is all Lyra, right? This is Lyra graphite again, and me building up from soft to crisper lines. Here's another Lyra. This one I posted a video on probably about a year ago, I think, on Instagram. This is all Lyra graphite. You can see how much work I'm putting in because I could build up and think. That's the great thing about it, because it's a lot of range. I can go really light on it and really dark on it, right? So it gives me time to think, okay? Now, just to prove the point that, you know, in the end, it's not the tool. It's like what you do and how you use it as the artist. This is wax, right? This is wax, so it's darker, but you can see it's being used the same way, right? It's still got levels of like thinking and drawing in it. So it's me drawing lightly with it, me drawing darker with it, but it gets to a richer black, right? It gets a lot cleaner, more clear, right? More clear line. All right, two more. Here's another wax drawing, right? This is all wax as well. You can see it almost looks like pencil, but this is actually all wax, right? Again, it's just about your sensitivity with your hand and how much pressure control you have. And then last but not least, I wanted to show you a China marker drawing. This is maybe about 4 years old, I would say. You could see the red drawing over here. What's cool about China marker or carandash versus the graphites is there's different colors. So you can use them in a way of like doing a little bit of planning and then kind of finishing off, right? So you can see the black is not actually very different from the red because I'm close in the red stage to what I want, but it gives me the chance to be a little bit more messy and think. And if I want to really clarify the drawing, then I can do that with the waxes, right? So a drawing might start off like this, right? Like this here, where I'm roughing it all out. I'm doing all the thinking. And then I might go to the black to like clean it up. So that's, you know, that's kind of fun to do as well, especially when you're exaggerating. Like I'll do that more when I'm actually pushing a design, because that takes a little bit more of my like brain power to figure out before I finalize, right? So that's everything for me. I'm a little over, so I'm gonna pass it on to Diego so you can talk about his supplies. Yeah, so let's see, I think that's all. You can just grab it whenever you want, actually, Diego.
All right, here I am. You need to mute your mic so it doesn't change the video. And spotlight me if you can. So let's see if this working. All right.
Okay, you're up. You're spotlighted.
Okay, that's awesome. Okay, guys. As you know, I'm also using smooth newsprint. I like to have like a thick amount of paper here below the one I'm drawing. And we're gonna be overlapping some tools. So I will try to skip the ones Mike talked about, but let's talk about a little bit of ink. I like using Sharpie, very old used Sharpie. So you can get like this. It's not like super new. You can see that. You can see difference like when it's kind of dry already. You can have this kind of line, which I really like for use with ink. When I'm going outside to draw with the sketchbook or something like that, I like to, obviously you draw small. When you draw small, you need to have a small tool. So I like to use this, I don't know how it's called. It's like say something here about mechanical or something like that. It's 0.3, no 0.4. This is 0.4. I don't know if you can see. So it's really, really, really thin. So if you're drawing in a small sketchbook, you'll be able to draw really nice with this small pens. Right, this is ink, this is all ink. And finally, talking about ink, I love this Tombow. It's like, and it's, I don't know if you're able to see, but it's kind of a brush. It's soft. So when you can go thin, but if you press, you get like thick lines. So that's really, really nice. And also when it gets a little dry, it looks more awesome. Okay, this is all ink. Now, Mike talked about this kind of pencil, which is the Fanel. with the little string. Well, I happen to have something like that, but as thick as this. It's like a crayon, but it's the waxy thing inside the that fennel. Actually, it's the same brand. It's Dixon. And it looks, of course, it looks pretty black. As you can see, it's almost like the Sharpie. It's kind of the same value as the Sharpie. So it's really, really black. As Mike said before, if you want to photograph your drawings, you maybe stay away from graphite. I will have something to show you in a bit about that. Another thing I like to use is this Polychromos from Faber-Castell. I don't know if that's focusing. Yeah, it's Polychromos. I like this blue. It looks really, really nice. And also you can get some soft lines and then you can get darker with this. This is really good. And it doesn't eat too much of the pencil when you're drawing. If you're using soft graphite, your soft graphite is kind of disappearing. Between 2 seconds, you start drawing and it starts to reduce the size. If you sharpen it, it goes faster. Here is something that I love to draw with, but you need to be very careful. These are Pete Pastel, and I'm sure Mike will agree with me. These kind of pencils, the problem with them to use it when you're drawing with force is they will break. The lead here is gonna break because it's kind of pastel. So you have to be very careful when you're using them, right? But I love the way you can shade with this. It gives you some awesome line. Let me change.
Yeah, to your point, you never want to drop one of those because once you drop it, it's over.
Yeah, pencil, yeah, if you want to sharpen then, it goes down. You sharpen again, it goes down. But I really, really love this. And as Mike said before, in this kind of pencil, you have like different colors. So you can get really arty with this. Sorry about that word. Another one of that kind, of that brand, is the Stabilo Carbothello, which is also pastel. It's softer than the Pete Pastel, but it also is the same thing. Like if you drop this, it's out, it's over. You need to buy a new one. But I really love the texture on the paper you can get with this. And also it gets really, really dark. So if you like shading or that stuff, this is really, really great. So now to get to the, I have these three things that I want to show you. These are animators pencils. These two are Colorace. And this is another brand. This is Caran d'Ache, but it makes the same idea. It's non-photo blue pencil. So when people used to animate traditionally, they take photos of the drawings and these things won't show. So you can draw over, you can sketch with this, like whatever you do. And when you photograph this, actually you can see that you barely can see this. I really can see it here, but you barely can see it on the camera. I have red and I have this other blue. I don't like those, sorry, but they're way, way too soft. They're not soft in a way of a graphite soft. It's too light, way too light.
Before you leave those, I just wanted to share, I asked Diego to bring these up too, because in the animation industry, these are really, really common, you know, like, a lot of prior, you know, when animation was pencil, a lot of animators would work with these Colorace pencils. They kind of have a waxy base to them. And then, you know, would do cleanup on top of that with a softer graphite, like maybe a 2 to a 4B graphite on top of, let's say, a light blue or a non-photo blue charcoal erase. That was sort of a very common 1-2 punch, you know.
Well, let's go now to the graphite, what I love. I really love graphite. So first, I have this, which is a pencil holder, actually a lid holder. This is a 6B lid that you can buy separately. They're different colors, and just grab it here. So if you want to get all dirty with graphite, you can have it here, and this is a 6B graphite. As Mike said before, this reflect light, I'm on a specific angle here, so you can see it, but if I move it, I don't know if we can get this to happen here, but you will see reflection. And if you take a photo, sometimes it won't show, and it doesn't look good. The other thing I use is this, this is a Progresso, Coiner Progresso pencil. It's an 8B, it's graphite also. It's have something like a cover on the outside, but it has no wood. So it's a pencil full of graphite. It's just graphite. And I use this, these are Derwent. This is pencil extender, I don't know the name. You can buy it on there are no Derwent, they're just, you can have like China thing. That sell like $1 or $3 of this. It's like exactly the same. You just put it here. And the thing, what I'm using this for is to get my pencils until they're like this. They're really, really small. I will show you later. Really, really small. And I can use it until the end, until there's no more pencil. So I can grab it here and still have a long pencil. But it's, once again, this is 8B. So this is 6B. And this is 8B. You can barely see the difference here. It depends also on the brand. They're not all 6B equal in different brands. Now I have this, a thick graphite bar. This is 8B also. And you will ask, how can you use this? The same way Mike said, he broke down in the middle. This is pretty short, so you don't need, and you can use it like that and start getting all sharp. This is pretty new, so you don't have those edges, but it will start creating those edges, and you get like a bullet shape with this. Well, here's a big bullet. Here's a Faber-Castell 9B. I don't know why I got a bunch of this, and they are not as black as there should be. This is a 9B. And as you can see, 9B, 8B, 6B, they all look kind of similar. So I asked Faber-Castell why this happened. And they say, well, this could be a bad bunch. I don't know. So they look good, but they're not as black as the Lyra. Here I have the Lyra, and well, this is a chalk holder, and I put the here, and this is a 9B. Here you can see this. You see the difference? This is water soluble Lyra 9B, and this is the Faber-Castell. It's a very, very different black to it. So yeah, there's difference between brands and between water soluble and no water soluble. Here I have something that I was talking with Mike. This is graphite. I cannot see anymore what's the graduation on this one, but it's super dusty. Let me show you what I mean. Take a look at that. This is graphite, but take a look at it. This is so messy, so messy. But it's fun. Can you see the pieces of graphite going out there? Well, this is a joke. I don't even know what brand it is. But it's so soft and so messy to use. If you like messy, that's the thing you have to get. And now to close this, these are the Stadler Mars Lumograph. I love these pencils. This is an old one. This is an 8B, and they used to come in blue, and not the lead, the pencil itself. And from 8B, 7B, I think 7B and 8B in these blue ones, they used to have more pigment, black pigment. So I love this pencil. In 2016, they change this blue pencil and they make it back to graphite, like this graphite. So I was really sad because when I bought a box of 12 of this, and they were like just like this, just pure graphite. I don't know if you can see this here. Just this is more black. The lead is more black, and when you're drawing, it lacks the reflection you have on common graphite. So I love this for drawing and taking photograph of, or film the drawings. So I asked Stadler what happened with those, and they told me they make a new one. That are the Stadler Mars Lumograph Black. And they even got more black pigment on this. So now these are my super favorite. I use it every day. I have like 200 boxes of them. Not really, but they are really, really black. I really love this one. Can you see the difference here? I can also get the Lyra here. This is the 9B. And if you look, this is black. This is more dark than this. And this has reflection and this one doesn't. So this is my favorite. Once again, this is a extender pencil, whatever. It's just for the sake of being able to have small pencil and use it until the end. But I really love this Stadler Black Root Lumograph. This is 8B. And you can get really, really black. So this is my favorite. And with that, I'm gonna close this. I can go over forever, but these are my basic tools that I like to use. So with that, let's go with Mritunjay and his magic tools. Once again, it's not the tools, it's the artist.
Thanks, Diego.
Yeah, thank you. That was, treasure boxes of just surprise and supplies. All right, can you hear me clearly? So just give me a check upon that.
Yep.
Yeah. All right, guys, let's jump right in. Change my camera. Okay. Hide this virtual background here. So the first tool is actually, so, you know, if all of you people know, I'm from India, and in India, look, most of these supplies that Diego Mike shows, it's not available. So what I actually have to do is have to find some alternatives to that. Okay, so I'm gonna share it to those alternatives, and actually they are from a company named Camlin, most of them. But if you find them in your country, that would be really great. You can try them. It's relatively cheap, according to the Libra graphite and all. But, they're also like super cheap. But, when you compare them, these are like, you can just like buy a three and $1 or something in them. So, yeah. So first of all, this is again. So again, this is the water soluble graphite. Okay. So again, the benefit of being water soluble, it's like really, really dark, So let's try that out, So you can see like, it works like that way, and it goes like from super light, I can just pull out these real light strokes, from these smooth strokes, to these, these really dark strokes, but one of the problems they have is because, of course, they're like water soluble, and because they're water soluble, you can see in the camera here, maybe not, it's not focusing enough, but you can see it's like crumbling up right now, okay? Because rainy season is going on right now in India, and just add to like really literally airtight pack them in an airtight container in those times. Okay. So yeah, I don't have like benefit of using them in rainy season, but I have a bunch of other supplies to show you. Okay. So that you can use. Okay. So another thing is, obviously, one of the addition you can do with the graphite is this, you know, this is a lead holder, you know, what you call it, lead holder, you know, Mike used to call it, yeah, used to call it like, what, Mike? You give it a name, right?
I don't know, I don't remember.
Yeah, okay, anyway, it doesn't matter.
Maybe it's the bullet holster or the gun, who knows?
Yeah, yeah, it's like a mag of the gun, right?
Yeah.
So, what you can do is like just push it from here and, you know, you can see like prongs coming out and you can slip this right into here. Okay. So yeah, something like this. But hopefully you can see like what it does to this, you know, it literally just like cracked it up, you know. So yeah, it's because just like rain is going on and it's like super, super smooth right now. So that's an addition, by the way. And if you really want to see like how good it performs, you know, while it's not like moisturized, that's some drawings which you can look at right now. So let's have a look at the drawing. So yeah, this is the one I did like in summertime. And yeah, you can see like how smooth the lines are. And I'm able to use them like at my pleasure really. You can see like some smooth lines here, and you can see dark, you can see like soft touch I'm using here. It's all with the single graphite, you know, it's nothing more than that. Okay, I have another drawing to show you really quick. And you can see like these are A2 size papers, you know, these are like literally A2 size papers here. And yeah, you can see again, this has like more line versatility here. You can see like really soft strokes, you know, you look at this one, you know, it's like super, super black here. So yeah, something like this, you know, you can get line versatility out of it, and it really, you can use it like instead of Lira if you can find it there, of course. You know, I'll just like send the links to Mike as Mike says, and he'll put it there, right? All right, so the second thing is, you know, I ordered this one like pretty recently, and this is called Artgrub, the company of Artgrub, and again, this is water soluble. You can see like it's written there, just like there, like water soluble here. So yeah, let's test it out. You know, how does it work? I actually find this really like super high quality. So I can get like, yeah, I got the taste of Lira now. So let's test it out. Wow, like super, super good, you know, super, super good. You know, you can see like I can pull up like soft strokes. And even if it's water soluble, it's not melting like all of those Camlin ones. So yeah, you can definitely say it's like an upgrade to the Camlin products, right? So, and Artgrub is an international company, so hope you'll find it all on the Amazon. I'll surely like send the link to it. Okay? So yeah, you can see like I can like flow around like super, super fluid. Okay, let's stretch it out again. Not happy with the drawing really. So yeah, so like this, and don't worry about your hand. You know, I just like my hand like this. You know, I can just like do something like this to make more feel I have on my hand, but you know, that's really, really good. It's super, super black here, okay? So yeah, you can buy this one, like Artgrub. Okay. The third thing is I have here is, it's actually a mix of charcoal and graphite. This is called Giocondo pencils. So they are actually a mix of the charcoal and the graphite. Listen the voice of it's making on paper here, but look at it, how dark it is. And this is brown, by the way. This is not like fully black, but they also make it in brown, black, and some other colors, like some earth colors. So yeah, mainly brown and blacks. You know, this is super, super good. Again, it's like it's more like more butter. It's more buttery. Okay. Let me test that out again. You can see like, yeah, really, really soft strokes here, and you know, really, really, I can go like super, super dark. Yeah, you know, one of the things that I want to bring out is contrast actually creates a lot of interest in your in your work. You know, it could be a drawing, it could be animation, it could be anything. So if you don't have like contrast to, you don't have like contrast, you know, it's gonna be a boring drawing, you know, I would say. So for example, I have one of the other supplies here as well. So we are, I'm just not sharing good supplies, I'm also sharing some bad supplies here. So look at this one. This was like total failure. And again, whenever I see any supply that was on sale, you know, I was just like, yeah, I just have to buy it. You know, that's my life goal. That becomes my life goal now for that time. So you can see, like this one, look at this one. This is super, super contrasty, I would say. But look at this one. You know, you can barely see it. And it doesn't matter how much pressure I'm applying on it, but it's the same, you know. It's like a total failure there. So, yeah. So I would say just go ahead and do the experiments yourself. You know, what's going to work for you, what's not going to work for you. And it's really upon you. You may find some supplies that's better than this or worse than this, you know. That's going to be like, yeah, more general.
Mritunjay, so, what was the brown one again? We have a question from the audience on what the brown was.
Oh, it's Giocondo. It's called Giocondo, you know.
Can you write the name of it on the paper there? Yeah.
My writing is super sloppy.
Giocondo. Okay. Thank you.
I will make sure that I'll send it to link to you so that they can buy it. All right. So yeah, one of the supplies that I use, you know, this is really close to my heart. I mean, it's not super, super good on smooth newsprint. You know, I got, if people don't know, I got smooth newsprint just like an year ago. You know, I just finally did it a year ago. Before that, I was practicing on these types of sketchbooks. I mean, this is not a sketchbook, but this is the copy actually, you know, from a local brand. You can see here. So it's just in Mattesi. So they actually sold, you know, these type of copy. And I find it actually smooth. I don't know if it's like a smooth newsprint or what, but I practice it a lot, you know. I used to fill these in just like 1 week or something. So you can see like experimentation hours and, you know, failures. So, yeah. And these are all done with this one. Yeah, these are all done with this pencil. So super, this cheapest material you can find in the box is this one. It's like 10 rupees. And if you want to convert it, it's like maybe 20 cents, like in US dollars. So,
wow.
20 cents. And you can like buy, I don't know, like four out of $1. Okay. So it's not that good on this smoothness one because this is really, really smooth. So, but you can see it's like still able to pull off some really, really good strokes, you know? So something like this, not super, super black. But you can see like how I'm able to like flow around and bring some contrast lines, right? And yeah, I can go like up to this draw. So yeah, super, super good. Okay, and some other supplies I have. So yeah, this is very close to my heart, you know, what all the Indian viewers that are watching and that those who will be watching it in the future, you know, definitely try this out, you know. And by this, I want to just prove that you don't need like super expensive or like super supplies, like specific supplies to make good drawings, right? So yeah, it's upon your hand. And this one, oh, Diego actually covered this one. I was gonna like say about this. This is Stadler again, AB. All right, some other supplies. So you can see like I have this whole giant box here. Delivery proves out that, you know, whatever the pencil that I see in the market, I just really want to buy it, yeah, for sure. So, and you can see here, like, how much, like, that you can see, like, little crumbling pieces. These are all, like, different. These are all, like, really different. Okay, so one of the supplies that I sometimes hate using and sometimes like using is this one. It's like, I don't know if it's like a really like ancient box, like Egyptian box, like 1,000 years old, but I just got it. Yeah, I just got it somewhere. And like, you can make them sound like,
yeah.
So you can see it's like a mix of graphite and charcoal. It's shining there. So it's the presence, it's showing the presence of the graphite. But yeah. So let's use it, you know, see how. Oh yeah, I can say it's like the blackest material I can found. It's even blacker than the charcoal. Yeah. So, and super, super messy again. Super, super messy again. Yeah, so something.
Big, what, you know? What is that? What is that again that you're drawing with?
I don't know.
You don't know. Of course, it's like the most awesome one.
Really nice thing. I love
it. Yeah, it's so awesome. Found it in like some cave.
Uh-huh. Yeah, it's literally written in Chinese there. I don't know. But yeah, some texts are written in English, but it's just like high gloss sketch charcoal shape. All of the things are written in Chinese. So yeah, it's got two of them.
Not to rush him, Mritunjay, but I think you're doing some digital stuff too. And we want to try to get to Swenly. What did you want to share? Was there anything you wanted to share digitally?
Yeah. Just really quick, you know, I'm just like, So, all right, guys, that's the end of the traditional one. I'm going to show you some digital supplies as well. So, these are basically the brushes that we use and provide to students on drawingforce.com. So basically, there's like two parts to it. There's basically Photoshop brushes and the Procreate brushes. So I'm going to use the Procreate brushes. And you can see here, you know, four written, which is like highlighted part. And one, two, there's like six or seven brushes here. Okay. So yeah, you can, we'll just put it link there. And when you sign up on drawingforce.com, there's like a offer that we're bringing in. When you sign up on drawingforce.com, you just get them for free. So make sure you do it. So yeah, PSK large pencil, just really like you are using the side of the lira, right? It's just like that. And it uses the Procreate 5 like brush engine and like Apple tilt pencil support together, you know, to create this really like fluid and brush strokes. So you can see when I'm using a pointy, so you can see making such marks, and I'm using it from its side, can see like how soft they're creating it. Okay? So that is one of the, I'm not going to cover like all the brushes, but what I'm going to be covering is my favorite two brushes, the PSK large pencil and then the PSK clean pencil. You'll be seeing them using it quite often. Okay? So once I get my softest with the PSK large, I used to go with this. You know, it really feels like I'm using Lira or, you know, some like same with the supply here. So yeah, really give me specificity over here. I can just like turn down the size really quick to get some specificity out of it, like something like this. And when you get the brushes, you just have to experiment on your own, like all these five. So what's your favorite? All right, that's my end of the session. I'm gonna hand it over to Sunday. Thank you.
Thanks, Mritunjay.
All right, stop broadcasting.
Yes, thank you. I'm still trying to figure out that ancient box that you showed, but yeah. Too bad. Let's see. Okay. You guys see my screen, right?
Not yet. There it is.
Yep. Yeah. Okay. So let's see. Just a couple of minutes left. So let's go through this quickly.
It's okay to go over a little bit.
So you guys went over pretty much the tools that I use also traditionally. These were done with 9B pencil. Let's see, it seems that it's having a little trouble showing that. Just clicked play and it kind of went crazy all of a sudden. Yeah, there it is. So these were done with 9B pencil on just regular printing paper. I just buy a stack of 500 most of the time. Almost 1,000 like Mritunjay. I'm half as good. So yeah, I really love the 9B pencils because they are so smooth and soft, which allows you to draw quickly, especially for like quick gesture drawings. I really like to use them. So I use, let's see, this, I think this is, okay. Faber Castle. Yeah, it's Faber Castle. These two are the same. Like this one is almost used up, as you can see. It's Faber Castle 9B. These are called graphite sticks, right? If I'm correct.
Yeah, those are the woodless. It's a woodless graphite, like what Diego had.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Mm-hmm. And this one is actually a Carandash 9B pencil. Kind of like the same. This one is a little softer, tends to get like, it's easier to get darker lines with it for me. It goes darker faster. But overall, it's kind of like the same effect. Let's see, let's go to the next one. And these drawings were done with wax-based pencils. I think they're also polychromos, like the one Diego showed. And I like these ones because it's easier for me to control like the range of values. I don't know if it's because I use them for a couple of years, but it's very easy for me to get like from super light to really dark with them. And these are one of my favorites. I would say even more than the 9Bs. I really love drawing with these.
What's and the blue again?
The color?
What company is that? Is the blue one?
Both are Faber Castell.
Oh, they are. Okay.
Yeah, both are the same, just different colors. This is mm-hmm. cobalt blue and this is Swartz black. Mm-hmm. And people always ask me why I draw with blue. And it's because my first, I studied industrial design for 2 years when I came to the Netherlands to study. And that was my first like formal drawing education. And they had us from day one draw with, I think in English it's called non-photo blue pencils, right, like right. the ones that don't show up when you make a photocopy of your drawings. Mm-hmm. So they had us draw with those non-photo blue pencils, no eraser, no ruler. You know, you either get it right or redraw it until you get it right. And then we cleaned up the drawings with a fine liner, and then we made a photocopy of it, and then the blue pencil would like not get reproduced. So you get a tight line drawing with just the fine liner lines. So I did it for 2 years, and after that, it kind of became like a habit for me to draw with blue pencils. So I kept that ever since, you know. So that's the story behind it, and I even brought it to digital. And nowadays, I consider it something that is very typical from me. It kind of like makes my work recognizable. So I just kept the habit since then. Let's see the next one, which is also one of my favorite tools to draw it, is ballpoint. And the ones I use are of no particular brand. I just bought a set of, I think like a pack with 50 or so in it. I like it for me, it's like between a pencil and like an ink pen, because you can build up, you can draw really light and then build up gradually to darker lines, but you cannot erase, you know. So for me, it's kind of like in between. And I really love, especially for my sketchbooks, to work with ballpoint, you know, because when I work with pencil in my sketchbooks, it's easy for things to start smudging and get messy. And with ballpoints, I can, again, build up from very light to very dark without having to worry about smudging my my lines. So that's why it's my tool of preference when working in my sketchbook. Okay, those were the traditional ones. Let me stop the share. And let's go to Photoshop. See, and go full screen. So these are the tools that I just showed you guys. So just the regular ballpoints, Faber-Castell, wax-based pencils, cobalt blue and source black, and Faber-Castell and Caran-d'Ache 9B graphite. So these are my tools of choice. And it's only recently actually that I went back to really drawing on paper again. And it kind of gave me like a fresh perspective. Like I kind of like run into some tricks when drawing that I was able to bring back to my digital work. And in terms of working digitally, actually there are two brushes that I use most of the time. And I just Googled charcoal brushes one day and found a set that I liked. And then I brought them into Photoshop and just modified them to my liking. I mainly use these two. Like if you notice, this one has like more texture. And this one is kind of a smoother, more like the force pencil that we, or the force brush that we use on the website. And I would say this one is the one I draw with the most. And man, it's been so long ago that I downloaded these that I have no idea where I would find them again. Actually, I just saved them as tool presets in Photoshop and made a backup of it. So I would always have them. Let me see, I think it's this one. Yeah, so this one has more of a texture to it. As you can see, it's very textured. So I like the effect. It kind of reminds me of just traditional like colored pencils. And most of the time I set my opacity and flow to pen pressure so I can get a nice range of lines from light to dark. And I also set my, I also have shape dynamics on. As you can see, it goes from thick to thin based on the pen pressure. So when I press harder, I get thicker lines. And when I press with less pressure, I have these lighter and thinner lines. So again, it gives me a good range. Let's see, the other one is this one. So this is like the softer one, as you can see. It doesn't have much texture to it. And it's a pretty nice brush actually to work with. Easy to build from very light, quite dark. So that's mostly what I use. And when I'm doing character design and inking, I would just use the same brushes, but I would disable the opacity and flow set on pen pressure. I would disable that so I get just a dark opaque line. Actually, let me see. So when I ink, I'm pretty much using an opaque line and I try to get my strokes like very clean and crisp. So that's it for me, guys. I don't know if there are any questions in the chat.
No, it's all good.
All right, so I think it's time, right?
Yeah. Yeah, thank you very much.
Yeah, you're welcome.
Let's see, let's stop. Can you stop your share?
Yes.
I think we'll go to our, go to our gallery view here just to close up. All right, so everyone, thanks for sticking around today and watching us go through the supplies that we use with drawing. To draw with force, if that's your goal, your focus, the best tools you want to get your hands on are ones that allow you to be most expressive, which means you want to go towards things that are softer, right? That's why most of us are using waxes or graphites, usually on the softer end. To Swanley's point, you can even get to something like a ballpoint pen, right? But that means you have to have good enough hand control to draw lightly and darkly with it. And I guess I just want to close with where we began, which is remember, It's not really the tool in the end. It's about the artist and what the artist does with that tool. Sure, some tools lend themselves better to certain things and certain looks and feels and experiences than others. It'd be hard to get force out of a felt tip pen like a brand new one, because all the ink's gonna come out immediately, right? There's no real like opacity change or anything, right? So, you know.
And go experiment, right, Mike? Go experiment.
Yeah, exactly. Yeah, Diego and I, before the meeting, were saying, you know, and this is sort of going to the art stores, to me, it's like going to the toy store. You know, if I see a new pen or a pencil, I'll always go buy one or two and just bring them home and see if I like them or not, you know. And it doesn't mean that those are the only tools you have to draw with. You know, when I go draw on location, I actually use the same pens Diego mentioned, the clear plastic ones. I forget the name of it now. But, you know, it just depends what I'm trying to accomplish, right? So certain tools lend themselves towards certain things more than others. But in the end, like I said, it's the artist who's really managing that. So, yeah. So hope you enjoyed today. It seems like the overarching comment, actually, the rest of you have been watching the chat, is to do a sketchbook tour. So who knows, maybe some point down the road before the end of this year, we'll try doing that. I don't have much in sketchbooks, I have to say, because I don't use them that much anymore. I would basically just go through a pile of newsprint paper. All my sketchbook stuff is mostly on location drawing. So we could always look at that too. Thanks again for joining us today. Next week, we will be back with some more interesting force live sessions for you guys. And we'll see you guys soon, right? Enjoy your weekend, stay safe, go draw, have fun buying some supplies. And we'll see you next Friday. Take care, everyone. Thanks, guys.
See you guys. Bye-bye.
All right, bye-bye.